All right, so in the last class, we were looking at how to implement edge-triggered registers by using latches, right? So the general structure that we saw, which is the most popular structure used for creating edge-triggered registers, is the so-called master-slave. Where the clock signal is given directly to the first latch, and the inverted version of the clock is given to the second latch, right? So the way that this works is, while the clock is equal to 1, the first latch is going to be transparent, and any change in D will come through to X. Okay? And when the clock goes from 1 to 0, at that point, the first latch goes into opaque mode, that is, it freezes. Right? No further changes are allowed to go through the first latch. Whatever is there at X at that point goes through and comes out at the output. Okay? Which means that at that point in time, Q, the output can change. It will take on whatever was the value at X at that point. Right? So this kind of structure essentially allows us to create the master-slave configuration. The first latch is called the master, the second one is called the slave, and the combination together acts as an edge-triggered register or flip-flop. Okay. Now if you wanted to create a positive edge-triggered flip-flop instead, then the way to do it is, there are two ways. Either you can first put the inverted clock to the master and the non-inverted clock to the slave, or you can change the nature of the latches so that both the latches are of type negative transparent, meaning that when the clock is low, they are transparent, and when the clock is high, they become opaque. Okay? So those are the two ways by which you can change this from a negative edge trigger to a positive edge trigger flip-flop. Okay? So, last time we looked at one configuration that used a full pair of transmission gates like a multiplexer in order to implement the full edge trigger flip-flop. We will now look at a couple of other simpler configurations. One of the approaches that is used is to say just use this pair of inverters as the feedback loop in order to store the data. Right? What happens over there is you are now relying on the strength of the signal in order to change the data that is stored inside the latch, right? So the relative strength of D versus whatever is there at X, that combination will decide whether the value at this intermediate point can be changed or not, right? So there is something which is driving from D, something else which is driving through the inverter from X. D has to be strong enough. Whatever is driving at D has to be a strong enough signal so that the value at the intermediate point can be raised up. Okay? So this complete combination once again acts like an edge-triggered flip-flop. One of the advantages as far as this is concerned is reduced load on the clock. One problem as far as this structure is concerned is the so-called reverse conduction, right? There is a possibility that there is a conducting path over here. That is to say, when the second latch is on, there is a conducting path from Q to X. Right? Because the transmission gate by itself does not specify that it will conduct only in one direction. It's not a one directional device. Depending on which side the voltage is higher, it will allow current to flow. Right? So because of that, there is a possible conducting path which goes backwards from Q to X and there all the way up to that input node. Right? This can be a problem because effectively what happens is the output noise is no longer isolated from the input clearly by means of a one-directional device. Okay. So what do you mean by one-directional device? An inverter over here, I'm considering it as a one-directional device. Any changes at the output will not show up at the input. Okay? Why is that? Because effectively the gain of the system is such that the conduction, right, the change in the input can easily cause a change in the output, but a change in the output will not correspondingly cause a change at the input. Okay? In this case, you don't have that. You have the devices in their normal direction of conduction. Right? So the inverter, if there is a change at Q, that second inverter can in turn pass it on to through the transmission gate to X, and that can go all the way up to the input. So that is one possible drawback with this structure of the edge-triggered flip-flop. Right? The advantage of course is you don't have two transmission gates at each stage, so the load on the clock has been reduced by a factor of two. Okay? Alright, there's one more configuration that we'll look at before we move on to another variety of, different way of looking at this same flip-flop. Yet another way of implementing this is to say using only NMOS transistors instead of transmission gates. So this is also a possible way of doing it, which further reduces the load on the clock, because effectively instead of having it also and gets it down to the same as the previous combination, right? But now you actually have the, you don't have to worry about the relative sizes of the inverter at least. Okay? Now what happens in this situation is, you have C and C bar, what do the signals look like? Typically if this is C, then C bar is going to be generated by putting C through an inverter, right? Which means that there will be a slightly delayed version of C which causes C bar. Okay? This is an area of a 1-to-1 overlap between clock and clock bar. This is a so-called 0-0 overlap. Okay? Both of them will occur for clocks that are generated in this way. right? Now, two things could happen. One is that the delay could happen either because clock bar is generated from clock as a result of putting it through an inverter, or even by means of just the delay due to the wiring between them. Either clock or clock bar could be the leading signal. Okay? In general, we are going to assume that clock is the leading signal, so clock bar sort of rises shortly after or changes its value shortly after clock has changed its value. Okay? So if this is the case, when you have a 1-1 overlap, or rather when you have a 0-0 overlap, you don't really have a problem. What is happening is that all the NMOS transistors are off. So there is no conduction anywhere. But a 1-1 overlap is problematic. Effectively what it means is that there is a direct path from input all the way to the output in the case of a 1-1 overlap. Okay? So now, first things first, what kind of latch is this? And what kind of flip-flop is this? Is it positive X triggered or negative X triggered? How do you find out whether this flip-flop is positive X triggered or negative X triggered? Huh? Right, so in this case what is it? The master is? How many of you think it is positive X triggered? How many think it's negative? Okay, so how does that work? Essentially when clock is equal to 1, the first case is conducting. Right? Because clock bar is going to be 0 and the feedback loop is broken over there. When clock goes from 1 to 0, that is when the first case stops conducting and goes into a feedback loop mode. Okay? So when the clock goes from 1 to 0, that is when the output Q will be allowed to change. And the first stage, the master stage, is going to go into hold mode. Okay? So if that is the case, this is a negative X trigger flip-flop, right? Now a negative X trigger flip-flop means this must be the active edge of the clock. Right? And only during this time, that is to say when the clock is going from 1 to 0, should you be seeing any changes at the output. The problem here is during the 1-1 overlap, that is to say when clock is equal to 1, clock bar is also equal to 1, we have direct conduction through this entire circuit, right? Because both this as well as this are conducting. Okay? There is a direct path from input to output during the 1-1 stage. Which means that during that time, whatever is there at the input can show up directly at the output and the output can change. The output can change when clock is going from 0 to 1, which will never happen. Right? This kind of problem arises a lot in many of the different flip-flop configurations that you have, right? This is just one particular example that I have taken to show a particularly problematic case. But in general, even for the other kinds of things, when you have transmission gates or when you have CMOS transistors, you can end up with a problem, that is the overlap between the clock can be an issue. Okay? So because of that, one of the approaches that was attempted was to say, is there some way by which you can build a structure which is essentially insensitive to overlap or less sensitive to the overlap between the clocks. Okay? For that, the structure that is used is using the tri-state inverter configuration that we have discussed earlier, right? So what are the tri-state inverters? What we said was, it's an inverter with a clock signal. The structure is something like this. Clock and clock bar are given to this. Right? So what is this structure? Is it a positive or negative latch? How does it work? What happens when clock is equal to 1? When clock is equal to 1, clock bar is equal to 0, so both of these intermediate transistors are not connected. When clock is equal to 0 and clock bar is equal to 1, it means that it just becomes a regular inverter. Okay? So this structure itself can be used as a latch, and what we are going to do is construct a master slave register out of two of these latches, and we want to see how, you know, that structure is essentially insensitive to overlap between the clocks. Insensitive meaning that it is not as strongly affected as other kinds of registers. Okay. Now before getting into that, I just want to look at a similar structure. So what have I done over here? I have interchanged the clock and data signal, right? Once again, there are four transistors, just as in the case of the tri-state inverter. The question is this structure also a tri-state inverter? Or is there any problem that you can see with this structure? Will this behave like a tri-state inverter? First of all, let's consider the case, what happens when T is equal to 0, T bar is equal to 1. Then what happens? Does it behave as an inverter? Yes. Right? When T is equal to 0 and T bar is equal to 1, everything is fine. At that point, whatever is there at D, and effectively the top CMOS and the bottom NMOS just drop out of the picture. Both are conducting. Right? So whatever changes happen at D, get inverted and come through to the output. Okay? But what happens when C is equal to 1 and C bar is equal to 0? At that point, what you want is that the output should be isolated from the input. There should be no change at all. Right? But that's not the case over here. Now, depending on the value of D, effectively what is happening is the other two transistors could be conducting. So, depending on the value of D, whether it goes high or low, the PMOS or NMOS could turn on or off. Right? Meaning that the voltage over here at X can be affected. There is no guarantee that it will be at 0 or at VDD even for some amount of time. It will directly follow whatever are the changes that are there at D. Okay? So this is not a good tri-state inverter. Okay? It may not always, but it can. The point over here is that any change in D can affect the output. It may not. D might remain stable at 1 or at 0. Right? So if D just remains constant at 1 or at 0, then nothing happens to it. Yeah. No, no, no. It's not a question of the parasitic capacitance. Right? Now it's a question of what is the voltage at this point? What is the voltage at this point? That determines whether or not D is conducting. Right? Which means that whatever charge was stored at this point that are marked as D over here, right, could end up flowing through to X and changing the voltage at X. So charge sharing between that point D and point X can take place. That will happen irrespective of what the other parasitic capacitances are like. Okay. The point over here is that transistor is now in a conducting state. The transistor directly connected to the output is in a conducting state. Okay. Which means that the voltage at the output can change depending on something which is there at the input. It is not just controlled by leakage at all. Leakage is different from charge sharing. In this case, we are talking about actual charge sharing. Right? There are two. There is some charge stored on a capacitance. There is some charge stored at the output. I have got a conducting transistor between them, which means that the charge will just split up between the two. Okay? Leakage is saying something different. Leakage is saying, okay, now there is nothing conducting connected to the output, but given long enough time, the leakage current through the NMOS or PMOS transistor could be large enough to change the voltages at that point. So there is a difference between these two different types of logic. Okay. Alright, so going back to the structure using the first slide, what we are saying is one more thing I just wanted to mention, because I noticed this in one of the exam papers. I am just marking this as VDD and this as ground. Okay. Now, in general, you need to be very clear about which is VDD, which is ground. The assumption is always that the one towards the top of the page is VDD and the one at the bottom of the page is ground. If you are planning to switch those around and make the other one as VDD or the other, you know, the top one as ground, you need to be very clear about which is which. Okay? Because there are certain situations in which, for example, I think I saw one paper where there was a CMOS in the pull down network. Okay? Now that can cause problems, and essentially that means that it's not behaving the way that it's expected to. A CMOS does not transfer a strong zero. So in general, PMOS is never used in the pull-down network, right? So those kind of things you need to be careful about when you are drawing a circuit. If there is any doubt about which is which, then please mark it explicitly as VDD and ground. Okay? So structurally this is easy to understand. You have two latches connected in a master slave configuration and they are acting as a edge triggered flip flop, edge triggered register. Okay. So what happens over here? Why is it that we can say that this structure is insensitive or not really strongly affected by clock skew? Right? Clock skew is the difference between the clock and clock bar signal, which in turn was what we were seeing earlier was causing problems for some structures of flip flop. Okay? What we are saying is in the present case, clock skew is not a problem. Okay? So let's look at the two configurations. We have a 1-1 overlap and a 0-0 overlap. So what happens during a 0-0 overlap is that C is equal to C bar is equal to 1, or rather 0. Right? When does that happen? According to our structure that we have over here, it will happen at this place. This is a 0-0 overlap. Right? In other words, at the negative edge of the clock. What kind of register is this? Is this positive edge triggered or negative edge triggered? When clock bar is equal to 1 and clock is equal to 0, that is when the first one is conducting. Right? So when clock is equal to 0, the first stage is conducting. When clock goes to 1, it stops conducting. So is this positive or negative edge triggered? This is a positive edge triggered D flip flop. Right? So the 0-0 overlap in our case corresponds to the point where it's at the negative edge. We need to make sure that there is no chance of any change of the input coming through to the output. Okay? So what happens during a 0-0 overlap? These two, both of them are conducting. Whereas this and this are going to be off. Okay? Now, look at the nature of this flip-flop. Effectively what it's doing is, there are two inverting stages. Right? The first stage inverts and the second stage once again inverts whatever was inverted by the first stage. So that the final output becomes matches with whatever was there at the input. Okay? So, because of that, the only transition that can happen over here, because it's the PMOS transistors that are conducting, right? The only possible transition is, let's say that D goes from 1 to 0 and that causes X to go from 0 to 1. Okay? X going 0 to 1 will cause this transistor. M8 will turn on. Okay? But that cannot change the value at Q because M7 is off. After this, what happens? What is the next transition change in the clock? After that, C bar will go to 1. Right? And M6 is anyway off. Or rather, C remains at 0. So in other words, during the entire 0-0 overlap, the Q will not change at all. Okay? So the problem that we saw in the previous case, where there is a possibility of the output changing at the wrong edge of the clock, that cannot happen over here. Okay? So that's good, that's at least one part of it taken care of. Question is, what do we do during the 1-1 overlap? Over here, the transistors M3 and M7 are both on. M2 and M6 are on. Okay. So what is the change that is allowed to happen at X? If the input rises from 0 to 1, X can discharge through M3 and M4 and go down to 0. So input changes from 0 to 1, X can change from 1 to 0. When is this happening? What we are saying is, this is at a time when both the clocks are overlapped at 1-1. Okay? The next transition that is going to happen, so this has happened at a time when clock E has just gone from 0 to 1. So in other words, this is the rising edge of the clock. It is the correct edge. It is the time when the data should be allowed to change. Okay? But what we are saying is that this is something problematic. This is some data which is changing. The clock has gone from 0 to 1. Clock bar has not yet gone from 1 to 0. During that time, some change is happening at the input. It is coming through to the output. Okay, it is coming through to X. X has gone from 1 to 0. And as a result of that, the next change that can happen once C bar becomes equal to 0, right, that can go through M5 and M6 to the output. Okay. Now, whether it will safely go through or not depends on how long was the overlap period, whether it had enough time to properly discharge the X or not. Okay? So in general, this is an undesirable thing. You don't really want to allow this kind of a change. But this at least is easy to sort of, just by definition itself, we can say, okay, this problem is not allowed to happen. Right? What we can say over here is, this is the rising edge of the clock. So don't allow this transition. How do I say that I will not allow the transition? I specify a hold step. To be greater than 1-1 overlap period. So if you have a 1-1 overlap, just say that there must be a hold time which is greater than that 1-1 overlap period. During that time, the data input D is not allowed to change. That guarantees that during that 1-1 overlap, there will be no change in X. And therefore no change in Q. If the D has changed before the 1-1 overlap period started, that's fine. It will be guaranteed to go through safely. If it changes during the 1-1 overlap period, that could be a problem because it may not have, X may not have time to discharge fully before the transition happens. Which is why you want to avoid this scenario. Okay? So how do you prevent that? You just put a hold time constraint and say that even though normally master slave flip-flop has zero hold time, for this case, because you know that there is a possible overlap, 1-1 overlap in the clock, you say there must be at least this much hold time constraint between the two. Okay? And as long as the hold time is satisfied, you are not allowed to change the D input so close to the clock edge. In turn, it cannot come through to the output. Okay? So effectively, this structure that we have seen over here, this kind of two tri-state inverters back to back forming a edge triggered register, this kind of structure is called clock CMOS or C square MOS. Okay. And this structure, what we say, what we claim is, it is not sensitive to overlap. We considered both the cases, the 0-0 overlap and the 1-1 overlap, and essentially showed that for both of them, the functionality can be either, it will be correct in the case of the 0-0 overlap, or in the case of the 1-1 overlap, we can at least put a definition of hold time such that this is not a problem anymore. Okay? At least there is no question of the data changing at the wrong edge of the clock, for sure. Okay, so this structure is also commonly used in a lot of different high-speed designs. One other advantage that can be used as far as this kind of structure is concerned is you can also incorporate logic directly into the line. Okay. What does that mean? It essentially means that rather than having only an inverter followed by another inverter, you could have some other logic also combined into the first stage of the line, first stage of the flip-flop. Right? This could be any pull-up and pull-down network corresponding to a CMOS circuit. And effectively what it behaves like is a combinational logic followed by an electrical register. So the overall block over there is combined into one and implemented, so you sort of save on some amount of transistors and also the speed, because part of the combination logic propagation delay is absorbed into the TTQ of the flip-flop itself or the setup time of the flip-flop. Okay? So you can combine logic like this. Alright, so there are some other structures as well that can be used for different kinds of flip-flops. Yes. There is no feedback. How does it? Oh, just on the capacitor. So, what is happening over here? This node X has some capacitance associated with it. Right? The capacitance acts as a memory. So, this is a dynamic register, right? What happens is when the first stage is transparent, the value at D will get inverted and come through to X. So if D is equal to 1, X will become 0. If D is 0, X will become equal to 1. After that, the clock change. The first stage becomes opaque, meaning that any further change in D will not change the voltage at X. But look at X now. The clock and clock bar are such that M2 and M3 are off. So it cannot conduct over there. There is no way that the charge over there that is stored at X can get shared or changed in any way. The only way that it can change is through leakage current. Leakage currents are usually much smaller than the on currents, which means that it will take a long time for it to discharge. But if you wait for sufficiently long, then yes, this will also have problems. Right? So it is a dynamic circuit. Alright. There are a number of other structures that can be used for implementing various kinds of registers and flip-flops. I'm not going to go through all of them. It's just that the main four ideas are what we have discussed over here so far. Right? You can have dynamic or static implementation. You can have the master-slave configuration in order to implement registers from latches. Right? There are problems associated with overlap, and there are ways of sort of getting around those problems as well. So those are the common kinds of structures that are there. Right? There is another class of such flip-flops which are called pulse latches. Which I am not going to go into at all over here. The idea over here is instead of giving a clock edge and saying that at the clock edge the data is allowed to change, you allow this to be transparent. But you make this a very short pulse. Now what happens when you make this a short pulse is only during that time, during that pulse, whatever change in data is there is allowed to come through to the output. Okay? So this is another way of constructing effectively edge-triggered latches, edge-triggered registers from transparent latches, from level-triggered latches. Okay? Like I said, I'm not going to go into the details of this. There are a few different structures that can be implemented in this fashion as well. These kind of latches, these kind of registers are used by quite a few high-speed designs. IBM typically uses this kind of latches for their registers in their high-speed processors. Okay? Alright. What I'm going to do next is take up the problem of timing analysis and the question of how do we decide the speed at which a given circuit can work. Okay. Now, in general, the idea over there is, supposing you have two registers, I'm going to talk about only in the context of registers to start with. We'll take up transparent latches a bit later. Any path through a circuit can be modeled something like this. There is a clock, there is combinational logic, and there are registers. Okay? Now, within this path, there is a clock to queue delay associated with the register, propagation delay associated with the combinational logic, and setup and hold time associated with the next register. Right? Why am I drawing it only for the next register? After all, this first register also has a setup and hold time. But as far as this particular path is concerned, the setup and hold time apply at the place where it is going to act as the input, not as the output. Okay? So, if I have a path of this sort through a circuit, right? What is the constraint that I can write down for correct operation of this circuit? What do I mean by a constraint? It is some condition that has to be satisfied between the different timing patterns for the correct operation of this circuit. Okay? Now, along with all of these parameters that we have so far, the clock itself also has a certain time period, which we call the T. Right? And ultimately, when we ask the question, what is the maximum speed or the maximum frequency at which the circuit can work, this T is what we are interested in finding out. Right? We want to get an estimate of what is the minimum value of T for which the circuit will function properly. That gives us the maximum frequency at which the circuit can be switched. Okay? And to sort of simplify and summarize the entire thing, it comes down to one equation. We need to look at the entire path of logic going from here through the clock, through the register, through the combinational logic, and into the next flip-flop. Okay? The total delay there is TCQ plus TPD, the combinational logic delay. This is the time, from the time that the positive clock wave reaches this point over here, this is the amount of time that it takes for it to reach the next flip-flop. Okay? And the definition of setup time is that, that what it says is, I must leave at least that much margin before the next clock edge. Okay? So TCQ, the time taken to get out of the first flip-flop, TPD, the total delay through the combinational logic, plus the guard interval for the second flip-flop, T setup, all of those added together must be less than or equal to the time period of the clock. Okay? This is the sort of most fundamental timing equation as far as any clock circuit is concerned. Okay? There is one more equation which comes up, which is related to the hold time. Over there what we are saying is, what is the time for the data to get out of the flip-flop? TCQ plus the minimum delay through the logic. This must be greater than or equal to the hold time of the second flip-flop. This is for the same clock cycle. Whereas the previous one was for the next clock cycle. Okay? So these two are the sort of most fundamental timing constraints that need to be satisfied for every single path through a circuit, for the circuit to work correctly. Right? As you can see, the first constraint actually determines T. It tells you something about what is the minimum clock period that can be used for the circuit. Whereas the second constraint does not say that. It does not have any relation to T. Okay? So it does not really constrain you in terms of the maximum or minimum speed of operation. Right? What we'll do is we'll take up another example in a little bit more detail in the next class and go through this in detail in order to find out how to estimate the actual value of T, the maximum speed at which the circuit can operate.